I'm Brian Henson. I'm the chairman of the Jim Henson Company. Stuffed and Unstrung started as a workshop, actually, classes within our company. We found that our puppeteers were sort of not ad-libbing as well as traditionally Jim Henson Company puppeteers have. We're sort of famous for going off script a little bit and ad-libbing. And we'd kind of lost a lot of that, and puppeteers were sticking to the script, and we thought everything needed to get a lot funnier. So we thought we would go to a good improv comedy instructor, and Patrick Bristow is who we decided to invite over to talk about training our puppeteers in improv comedy, to get them off of script and get them thinking about character development and sharpening up their comedy. And that started, about 4 years ago now. And it was just a workshop. The puppeteers really responded to it. Patrick Bristow really responded to it. It's great fun to do improv comedy with puppets. And Patrick thought we should try to put an audience in front of one of the workshops, basically in front of the class, and see how the performers rose to having an audience there. Because he said, you know, it's a really interesting test, because sometimes it gets even funnier. And so I thought, well, if we're inviting an audience, let's do it right. So I put in a proper studio audience at our studios in Los Angeles. And it was just a little showcase, and it was just for fun. But there was a producer from the Aspen Comedy Festival who happened to be there as a friend of a friend. And she said, I'd like to book you into the Aspen Comedy Festival. And we said, well, there isn't really a show to book in. This is just a little showcase, and it's really our workshops. And she said, no, it's great. I love it. Just do exactly what you did. So we took a show to the Aspen Comedy Festival called Puppet Up at that point. And in Aspen, we just did three shows. And in Aspen, there was a producer from the Edinburgh Fringe Festival who said, please come to Edinburgh. So we sent a troupe to Edinburgh. And then in Edinburgh, there was a producer from the Melbourne Comedy Festival. So we went to Melbourne. So it's one of these shows that kind of organically developed, and it started developing momentum way before I even thought there was a show here. And then after the success at Melbourne Comedy Festival, then we regrouped back in LA and we went back into workshopping and decided to develop a proper show. And that's when we started working on Stuffed and Unstrung, which is a much bigger and sharper version of Puppet Up. And we wanted to premiere it in New York, because New York is sort of the home of the Jim Henson Company, and it's sort of the tone and flavor always of the puppet work that we've done traditionally. And that's what brought us here, and now we're here. Well, it's kind of fun. I think it's a lot richer than what we call fleshy improv. I think it's very funny. Puppet improv and fleshy improv. But it's... Well, first of all, you're improvising through a puppet, so you're not always yourself. You're a cow, or you're a pig, or you're an old woman. You know, whatever puppet you pick, or you're a demon. You know, whatever you pick up, that's what you get to be in the scene, and that sort of adds a whole liberating energy to the show and to the comedy. You can get a lot more outrageous and a little crazier. In many ways, I think it's easier in some ways, or it's more entertaining or more guaranteed to be entertaining than traditional improvising, again, because you're not just you in your body. A puppet that starts to improvise badly is almost funnier than the puppet that's improvising well. So you sort of are, the show gets better when the improvising is really good. But also the show can sometimes get better when the improvising sort of goes a little wrong, and that's sort of a blessing to improvising with puppets. The challenge is, well, there's a huge challenge, which is when you're improvising, you're meant to sort of clear your mind completely, just be open and funny and paying attention. And with puppets, especially in our company, we sort of demand a very high standard of puppetry. So it's a real technical skill. So while you're trying to improvise, you're also trying to puppeteer. You're doing everything that you need to do to perform a puppet in our style for a camera. And so that's the challenge. You have a big technical aspect of what you're doing whilst you're creatively trying to improvise. And I'd say that is a challenge, but it also is, again, it's helpful. It's helpful to have the discipline of, okay, I'm doing something that's quite precise over here, the working of the puppet, and I'm doing something that's very imprecise and creative and unleashed over here, which is the comedy side. And it's kind of nice to allow your brain to be doing those two things at once. It's actually good when the performers are nervous because it kind of sharpens up your brain and a little bit of adrenaline is good. Initially, it's really tough. I think initially it's terrifying because going into a show where you know, oh, I'm going to be on stage for 2 hours, I have no lines to memorize, I have nothing really prepared. And actually, I say that the show is not all improvising. The show is probably 60% improvising and 40% not. So there's quite a bit of it that we do have prepared. And that part of it, you have memorized and you've rehearsed it and you're prepared, just like any show. But the fact that most of the show you can't be prepared for, you have no idea really what's coming, is initially very nerve-wracking. By now, it's kind of fun. You get used to it. You look forward to the adrenaline of the stage fright before you go out.
Hello, fellow strippers. Okay, I know that we've all been making good money recently, stripping and doing our pole dancing. But we could always do better. We could always improve. So I brought in an expert from the freest country for women, India.
This is certainly the raunchiest, if you use that word, raunchy. The roots of Jim Henson, though, was adult comedy. The first show that my dad and my mom did together was a comedy series, short form, that went in the middle of late night news. And then through all of their career, it was always the Ed Sullivan Show. It was variety act. My dad was on the Jimmy Dean Show for a few years. It was actually what my dad did, and with the Muppets, the years with the Muppets, it was really all targeted to adults. It was in a time when everything had to be safe for the whole family. But he was targeting adults. Sesame Street was really the first kids show that my dad did. Well, yeah, pretty much. He did a couple of TV specials that were targeted for kids before Sesame Street. But really, it's kind of going back to our roots when we start to get adult. This show gets very adult sometimes, and that's because of the audience. There's an awful lot of scenes where we don't know what the scene's going to be about. We ask the audience, pick a place that this scene is happening, pick the relationship, tell us who they are, things like that. And if the audience is in a kind of naughty, raunchy mood, then they're going to make naughty, raunchy suggestions, and then we take them and we do the scene anyway. And that's part of the fun. We try to keep it a classy show, but it certainly is blue at times. And it all depends on the audience. Sometimes we'll have audiences that don't really want us to go too far in that direction. I think you would love it. Really, initially, what I very quickly realized that I was loving about the show was because it reminded me of when I was a kid and I would visit the sets where my dad was shooting with the other puppeteers. And one of the funnest things was watching what they did before the director called action and after the director called cut. And they'd keep their hands in the puppets, they'd stay in character, and then they'd start goofing around with each other and be off of script, and it would get quite blue. And it was a whole lot of fun. And in many ways, what we've done with this show is just taken that part of my early memories of visiting my dad shooting with the Muppets and taking that and making a show that's really an expansion of that and presenting a show that's all that. And that was always my father's favorite part about shooting as well. Often, my dad would shoot very, very late. He was quite a workaholic. They would do 20 hour shoots and stuff like that. And he could be on a set at 2:30 in the morning where all the puppeteers were just laughing so hysterically at each other that they can't actually do the scene, and they'd have to wait until they'd gotten themselves back into under control to do the scene. And again, we're kind of trying to be in that place that's just so absurd and irreverent and hysterical. And it's something that at our company, we're so irreverent about everything. We're sort of irreverent about the establishment. We're irreverent about civilization. We're irreverent about philosophy. We're irreverent about religion. We're also irreverent. We have an irreverent attitude towards puppets as well. So a lot of what we do is we're kind of making fun of the puppets for being puppets, even while we're doing it. And again, that all feeds into the absurdity of this show. In the show, we have recreated two sketches that my dad had, or pieces that my dad had developed. One that he had developed with my mother, one that Frank Oz had developed with my dad. And these are old pieces from the 50s and 60s, and we're going to develop more too, so that there'll be others of those. So it's sprinkled in there as a spice into the show. It's really great to do one piece, I've Grown Accustomed to Your Faces, my dad developed in 1956 when he was 20 years old. And it's great to do that piece again now and see that it still really works as well as it ever did. Oh, well, I can't tell you. It would be telling you the end. It's one character lip-syncing, because in the early days, that's what my dad was doing. My dad and my mom, they would take what were popular hits and lip-sync to them with puppets and do a ridiculous story. So it's Rosemary Clooney, right, the singer? Yes, Clooney, singing I've Grown Accustomed to Your Face, which is, you know, really a love song. And but what we see on stage is we see one puppet that's got a ridiculous blonde wig on, and she looks ridiculous. And next to her is a head that's just a piece of fabric with a pretty face on it. And then while she's singing I've Grown Accustomed to Your Face to this little head next to her, the head eats the cloth fabric and swallows it, and it's sort of this weird demonic character there who then tries to eat the singer. And but it's a lot of fun. So there's a couple of pieces, yes, like that. When I was in high school, I was always an artist. I always was doing filmmaking things and animation things and sculpture. I always very much enjoyed arts, and it was so central in my family. My mother was also an art teacher, as well as founding the Henson Company with my dad. There was a lot of art going on in our household. But curriculum-wise, I was drawn to the sciences and specifically to physics, and I really enjoyed it. And I think for a little while there, I was really thinking my schooling would be in physics, that was something I loved. And that, probably though, by the time I was 17, I already knew that I was probably going to go into film. At that point, I thought probably special effects, something like that. And indeed, the early days when I was working with my dad after I left school, I only went to less than 1 year of college. And then I was transferring, and then I delayed my transfer, and I did a movie and then another movie, and then I never finished college. But initially, when I was working with my dad, it was in special effects puppets with radio control and motors and puppet effects. The first big thing that I did with my dad was the bicycle sequence in the Great Muppet Caper, where Kermit and Piggy are riding bicycles in Battersea Park in London. And that was a complex marionetting and cranes driving through the park. It was a complicated scene, and I did that with my dad. And so I was already sort of mixing my science physics enthusiasm with entertainment and directing and puppetry. But by the time I was 17, certainly by the time I was 19, I knew that show business was where I was going to end up. And I had my sights on being a director. Boy, that's one of those questions you almost have to ask somebody else. One thing, I guess I learned a couple of good lessons from my dad. One was when you're creating something, that what you want when you're working with a team of other artists is you want everybody to work with some creative freedom so that you really get the best out of everybody. And he used to say, people would say to him, when you finish a movie, well, did it come out as good as you thought it was going to? Or did it come out the way you intended it to come out? And my dad's answer would be usually something to the effect of, A, it came out better than he imagined, but also he said, no, it'd be impossible for me to imagine the way it will come out. He said, yes, I storyboarded it, I had a plan, but then I work with an army of great artists, and I want all of them to create inside that creation. So as a director, as a leader, and myself as a director and a leader, I kind of try to make sure that we hold on to the vision and kind of corral it. But by the time you finish whatever the project is, a TV show, a series, a movie, a stage show, it should be a product of what all those people can do. And therefore, it can never be what you imagined it would be in the beginning. And it should be something that only that group of people could have made with everybody invested. So in that sense, he and I try to emulate his approach of really get the most out of people by allowing them to experiment and certainly allowing people to make mistakes. I think in a creative effort, in any creative effort, people need to be able to be taking risks. And if it turns out to be a mistake and it turns out not to have been the right choice, that should be applauded, you know, by everybody, and we'll come up with another plan. But if everybody's trying to stay safe, then you never really create something new and different and surprising. And so I try to operate like him in that sense. My dad was a very, very gentle soul. I'm probably not quite as gentle maybe as him. But I certainly try to respect people and create an environment where people can flourish. Where does a character come from? Because a character, at the end of the day, a character will be the combination of the writing of the character, the voicing of the character, the personality of the character, and what the character looks like. And characters in our company can develop from basically three different directions. They can develop as a scripted character first. It could be a writer that came up with the idea of a character, described it in a script, and then wrote some dialogue. And that's where it starts from. And then you add a performer who puts a whole additional layer on top of that, and you add a puppet design and the puppet that the puppet builder has built, and that adds a whole layer. And in the end, that gives you the complete character. But sometimes the characters start in the script. Sometimes the characters start by a puppet designer drawing a sketch and saying, how does that look? Sometimes many of the best puppets actually didn't start with anything that specific. It starts with saying to puppet builders, I need some weird looking monsters for this scene. And you kind of describe it. And then the puppet builders actually just fabricate it on their table, just start putting it together. And some very good characters start that way, where it's a puppet first, and somebody comes in with a puppet and says, how do you like this? And we all go, that's great. Okay, now let's put a character voice to it, and let's put script to it. And sometimes it can be the puppeteer. Often a puppeteer will come in and say, you know, I've got this crazy aunt, and she always talks like this. And then you start working it up, and then you end up making, you know, a puppet that embodies that personality. So it comes from, I said, three directions. It can be four. It can be a character designer doing an illustration. It can be a puppet builder fabricating a puppet on their desk, on their bench. It can be a puppeteer coming in with personality in their mind, or it can come from the writer writing a character. Always, but it's usually, by the time you finish it, it never is that anymore. Well, no, I guess sometimes we have built puppets of specific celebrities, occasionally. Often, the initial idea behind a character will be somebody that somebody knows. But by the time you add all of the creating of the puppet to the scripting and everything, by the time it's finished, even if you showed that character to the person that you had started with, they would have no idea. Puppets are interesting because they appear to be very, very restrictive, because they appear to be non-emotional, because they don't have much facial features. Not much movement in their facial features. Some puppets have a little bit more, some have almost none. And initially that looks restrictive because it looks like that's going to be impossible for that character to emote. The truth is what happens in the end is it allows the audience to feel the emotion and put it together in their head. So, for instance, a character like Kermit the Frog is a very, very, very simple puppet, but he's a very emotional character, and that comes in the rhythms of the movement of the character, the way that the character's moving, the way the character's voicing, and then the audience doing a lot of the work of really feeling like they're seeing something that they're not seeing. Often when we write puppet scripts, it'll say, and they all smiled great big smiles. Well, of course, a puppet never smiles a great big smile, but boy, you can write that scene, you can shoot that scene, and you can show it to people, and they'll say, I love that scene where they all ended with great big smiles. It's like, yeah, but it never really happened. You just sort of imagined it. So the good puppeteers, as long as you believe that that character is emoting, the puppeteer, usually the audience gets it, and it's a weird and wonderful connection that happens, because I can't even really tell you exactly how it works, but that it really does work. I mean, it says something about the human eye and our ability to read people and then be able to read puppets the way we read people. Oh, sure, because it's a completely different thing that you're trying to do with a puppet. It's, or at least usually in our company, when usually a puppet is made of felt and its eyes are often, you know, white plastic, and it's stuffed with foam rubber or stuffing, and that's part of what it is. That's what makes the puppet funny. And when you're doing the puppet, if you're doing a puppet of a goat, well, it's not actually a goat that's playing the scene. What's funny is it's a goat that's made out of yellow felt and foam rubber and ping pong ball eyes, and that's part of what the entertainment is. If you were to rip the arm off the goat, there would be cotton wool that comes out, not blood. And that's not something you can copy with 3D digital animation. That's specific to puppetry. So I think there will always be a place for puppetry. 3D animation, I think people were asking the same question when we were doing animatronics through the 80s and 90s, when we were doing animatronic characters, where we were building puppet characters, but you were meant to believe if you cut them, they would bleed, with Dark Crystal and Labyrinth, and more recently, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy or Where the Wild Things Are. Those are characters that are meant to be closer to the illusion of living, breathing characters. And I think animatronics has been largely replaced and certainly enhanced by 3D digital animation. But I think the place for puppetry, the simplicity of what you're doing with puppetry, well, you can't beat the simplicity of a puppet and a camera, and there you are, and you're done. So I don't think puppetry is going anywhere fast. I think it's one of the oldest art forms in the world, and I think it'll still be going strong. The Muppets were always sort of like my family growing up, and I didn't really have favorites. Kermit the Frog was most similar to my dad, and it was most, Kermit is most similar to my dad when he was in a playful mood, and of course, it was the most fun to be with my dad when he was in a playful mood. So I would tend to say Kermit was maybe my favorite character. But truthfully, they were all so a part of my life growing up that it's more like saying, who's your favorite brother or sister? You wouldn't really have an answer. I think it's still in question as to whether they really ever got married. They're one of those relationships, you know? They're going to be together and they're going to be pulled apart, and I don't know. Who could live with Miss Piggy? It's hard, even for Kermit. That's hard.